Okay, now Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7. If you'll remember, last week we touched on, or actually did more than touch on, we talked about verse 12 of Matthew chapter 7, which really is essentially the golden rule, or what we call the golden rule: do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And so we talked about that briefly, about ways that we could put that into practice. And you guys had several good ideas and things to say. So I hope, we're not going to go around the room and ask anybody, but I hope that you will, that you have put those things into practice this last week, and that you'll continue doing that. If we use that as a measure or standard for our lives, then we will have really, really big blessings in our life for having treated people the way we want to be treated. Now let's begin in verse 13. Jesus says, "Enter ye into the straight gate," at the straight gate rather, "for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat. Because straight is the gate and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it." Throughout the Sermon on the Mount, and I'll quickly one more time remind you that the Sermon on the Mount is chapter 5, 6, and 7 of Matthew. The entirety of those chapters are one continuous sermon by the Lord Jesus Christ, referred to as the Sermon on the Mount. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus has been teaching the standards of his kingdom, or of God's kingdom, and he's been explaining all along the way what kingdom people are like and what kingdom people are not like. And of course he uses the contrast much of the way through there, the contrast of the Pharisees and scribes, the so-called religious pious people of the day, and he calls them out on the way they are, their self-righteousness and all of these things. And then he contrasts that with the right things and the right ways things should be handled. And so now he's come to a point in the sermon, as we near the end of it, where he really just is calling for a choice. He says, "Enter in," "enter ye in," in verse 13, and that just simply demands a decision. It what he's telling them is enter into what? The kingdom of God. He says, really, the straight gate, but that's just simply a reference to the kingdom of God. The way to the kingdom is a straight gate. The word straight is not what you and I would think. It simply means narrow, okay? And so he's talking about enter into the kingdom of God, and it is a narrow way in doing that. He's simply saying you've got to make a choice. Either you choose to take the one and only way to heaven, which is through him, or you choose not to, which would be, by choosing not to, you're taking what this scripture refers to as the wide gate, which leadeth unto destruction. Now, this has been the case all throughout history when you think about it. There's always been a broad way where the droves go, and there's always been that narrow way which God says is the way to him. It goes all the way back, as far back as the book of Genesis. Man has always had numerous ideas that he's created in his mind of how he thinks that you can be right with God. And of course God has one way to be right with him. And so you go all the way back to the book of Genesis and you see this first of all in Cain and Abel. Abel brought before God what was acceptable. He brought a lamb out of his flock, and he offered to God what was acceptable. That's the only way to please God, was the acceptable sacrifice that God had appointed. Cain, on the other hand, took the broad way, and he just brought before God what he thought would be best. You see, that doesn't work that way. God says what he requires. He requires a blood sacrifice. In Cain's eyes, he offered, the Bible says something, the fruit of the ground. He was a farmer. He was a tiller of the ground, the scripture says. So he lived out of the garden, if you will. So he either brought vegetables or fruit or some sort of something that was produced from the ground. And in his mind, it made perfect sense. In his mind, it was logical. Why wouldn't I be able to offer something that I had worked hard to produce? It made sense to him, okay? But in his eyes, why wouldn't that be just as good an offering as what Abel did? And the answer to that question is because God makes the rules, God sets the standard, and God's standard requires a blood sacrifice. Enough said. Doesn't matter how good your idea is. It doesn't matter how much logic you think is to that. If it's contrary to a blood sacrifice, it's not going to be accepted to God. And you see, that what he offered, Cain offered, was the way to destruction. The way to destruction is a broad way. Because what it involves, the broad way involves, is a jillion of man's ideas of how to get to God. Man has a lot of ideas, guys, and countless notions of how they think that they can get to God. So Cain went with his own idea, and Abel, on the other hand, went with not his own idea, but what God said was required and what was expected of him, and that narrow way. And so the question is, how did it work for the two of them? Well, the scripture is very clear that Abel's offering was accepted and Cain's was rejected. And it will be no different for you and I or any of the people that would have been in the crowd while Jesus was bringing this Sermon on the Mount. There's a way to God, and that's through his Son, Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, sacrificed on Calvary. And we can either take that way and let it lead us to life, or we can choose another route, and there's a lot of them, and it's going to lead us to destruction. It's no different for us than it was Cain and Abel. There's one way. It's through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And so whichever one of those ways, whether it be the broad or the narrow, that we choose, it's going to determine where we end up, destruction or the way to life, okay? It's not that hard to understand. It's not that complicated. Jesus makes it very clear. But still, the question is, when it's that clear, God's make it that direct, that there's just one way, why is it that man almost always will choose the broad way 10-1? Why is that? I mean, if it's laid out by God, the scripture says here, many there be that go in thereat on the wide gate. Why do many, when they have the instructions, when they have the one way presented to them, why do many choose to go a way that they think is better? Well, a lot of it is because if you do that, you can make an easier way. A lot of it has to do with, remember, man is conceiving of his own ideas of how to get to God. So naturally, if man's going to come up with a way, he's going to come up with a way that's easier, a way that is attractive, inclusive, permissive, a way that would have fewer rules, a way that would make fewer demands upon your life, a way that had fewer restrictions, would require less commitment. You're just going to come up with, in a nutshell, a way that's more convenient, right? And you say, well, what's wrong with convenience? There's nothing wrong with convenience, if you're just concerned about this life. But if you're concerned about eternal life, there's a lot wrong with convenience. We don't have the convenience of choosing a different way. We've got one way that leads to life, or we can go with convenience and find that way leads to destruction. It seems right to man, but it always turns out wrong, you see. The Bible says in Proverbs 14:12, there's a way that seemeth right unto man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. So Jesus being the only way to God is not popular simply because it's narrow. It requires humility, self-denial. It requires depending upon God for grace rather than depending upon our own works or efforts. And it leaves no room. God's way, the one way, the narrow way, leaves no room for you and I to boast and say, look at me. I want you to see what I have done. Man, and we don't like that. Man wants to contribute in some way to his salvation. He wants to at least have something that he can achieve along with the salvation in order that he might experience some of the glory. And it doesn't work that way. God doesn't share his glory. He does not share his glory. And so he makes it such that he alone acquired the salvation for us, and what's left for us is to simply surrender to that plan and put our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and then there's no room to boast. He gets all the glory, we get all the salvation we need, and it works out well. We just have a hard time with it. Still, many people reject that narrow way and go with an option that better suits their own pride or their own desires, and really that was the driving force when you think about Cain and Abel. That was the driving force behind Cain's choice, was his pride, and you don't really see that until he's confronted by God, when he is rejected by God and confronted with that he'd come the wrong way. Then you see his pride. Why? Because he got angry. See, the Bible says he was wroth. If he'd just been humble, if he just made a simple mistake and then realized he was wrong and then said, "Oh, okay, God, I'm sorry, I repent. Let me go get the proper satisfaction. I mean, a sacrifice." Then you would see that he had the right motivation. His motivation from the word go was pride, and otherwise he would have corrected his mistake, went the narrow way, which would have indicated humility. In fact, God gave him an opportunity. Let me read to you out of Genesis 4 and verse 6. It says, "And the Lord said unto Cain, Why art thou wroth? And why is thy countenance fallen? If thou doest well, shall thou not be accepted?" You see, God's reasoning with Cain, he actually wants him to correct his mistake. He actually wants him to do well. And he wants him to stop the broad way, his own ideas, and go with his God's one way, his plan of salvation. Make that right choice, and then it'll be good. But here's the deal: God leaves that choice up to man. He doesn't force it upon him. In fact, he goes on and he says to Cain, "If thou doest well, then sin lieth at the door." He says, and let me back up. He says, "If thou doest well, shalt thou not be accepted? Or, and if thou doest not well, sin lieth at the door." God's saying, it's your choice. But God wants him to make the right choice. That's his grace. He wants you and I to make the right choice, but he does leave the choice up to us. And of course, we know the path that Cain took. He stayed with the broad way, and it did in fact lead him to destruction. Because what did he do? He murdered his brother Abel out of his pride. He couldn't stand the fact that his brother was right and he was wrong, and he resented him. And so he murdered his brother, and then he lived the remainder of his life, the scripture says, a fugitive and a vagabond. And if you look at those two words together, it simply speaks of a life of instability and grief. He lived a miserable life from there on out because he chose the wrong path. And it cost him. And many people still make that choice today. Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father except by me." And people, with that being proclaimed, people still reject that one way and go with their own ideas, and it still leads to the same destruction. And I'll tell you something else, and I'm finishing up here. We still see, and we always will see, the resentment and the hostility of those on the broad path towards those that have chosen the narrow. Cain didn't like it because Abel had made the right choice and pleased God. And people today, the mindset in many cases are, when you and I stand for Jesus and Jesus is the only way, and we declare that, then it's, how dare you tell me that I'm wrong? How dare me? Who are you? Or what makes you so good? Nothing. It's just Jesus says there's one way. And there's still a hostility and resentment towards the narrow path. And it'll always be that way until Jesus returns. The next time we're together, we're going to talk about false prophets and be looking at some of that. And I hope that you will leave and go from here and practice the golden rule, okay? And do unto others as you have them do unto you. Guys, I encourage you by Sunday to have thought of someone that you can invite to church. Last Sunday, we had two families, I believe, that had returned for the first time, if I'm not mistaken. The Sunday before that, I think we had three. So we're getting people back that we hadn't had in a long time. We still got some holdouts. If you know who they are, go get them. Say, Governor Abbott said go to church. Okay? And if you don't, Brother Chris is going to mandate it. Okay? All right. Let's stand and we'll be dismissed in a prayer. Okay? Appreciate you guys being so faithful. Glad to see you tonight. Brother Jim, will you lead us in prayer, please?